At first glance, you may be forgiven for thinking that this Renaissance-style chateau is somewhere in the Loire Valley in the middle of France. But in fact, it's much closer to home. Find out where I am in just a moment. These house hunters are laying all their cards on the table.
The dining room might be a bit small. We've got quite a big square table.
So you're going to buy a house around your dining table?
So, will any of our properties reveal a winning hand?
Look at the character. Look at the fireplace. I mean, this is just perfect country cottage stuff.
Keep going, Reese. Keep going. It's going to break soon.
He's got his rosy tinted glasses on. I can see the things.
Today I'm in Buckinghamshire, and this is Wadston Manor, just outside of Aylesbury. Now, until 1874, this was just a simple hill in empty farmland. And then enter Baron Ferdinand de Rothschild, who bought the 165-acre plot and set about building this fantastical French chateau to entertain his Victorian high society friends. Nowadays, the guest list extends to hundreds of thousands of visitors who come to enjoy the house and the gardens and acres of beautiful Buckinghamshire. One of England's home counties, Buckinghamshire borders Greater London to the southeast. The county's southern section is dominated by the chalk escarpment of the Chiltern Hills, much of which is designated an area of outstanding natural beauty. But as well as pretty pastoral views, the county boasts more National Trust properties than any other, including the magnificent Clifton House and Gardens, located above the banks of the River Thames. Also in the care of the National Trust is the historic village of West Wickham. Here it's possible to take a stroll along a high street lined with cottages and inns dating from the 16th to the 18th centuries, before climbing West Wickham Hill for magnificent views. This is the site of the impressive 18th century West Wickham House, featuring architectural styles from early Palladian to neoclassical and built for Sir Francis Dashwood. But as well as these monuments to the wealthy elite, Buckinghamshire is replete with historic churches built to serve the village congregations. At Lillingston Lovell, St Mary's retains some early 13th century features, as does the Church of St Nicholas at nearby Lillingston Darrell, although this was largely restored in the 19th century after falling into disrepair. So if you're looking for a slice of classic English country life, packed with centuries-old villages and architectural gems, Buckinghamshire is certainly a county to head to. Just last week, the average UK detached house price hit a record high of £300,000. That's a 50% increase in the last decade. And here in Buckinghamshire, the figures are also quite striking. The average here is £625,000. That's more than double the UK figure. That is in part explained by beautiful countryside and also the proximity to London. But as always, the further north in the county you go, away from the capital, the further your money goes. So let's meet the couple who have chosen to make Buckinghamshire their home. Today's buyers are Reese and Cathy, who are currently living in rented accommodation on the outskirts of Reading in Berkshire, after relocating with their two sons from South Africa a few months ago.
I came over in September last year to get the boys into school, and Reese followed through permanently in November.
We didn't want to rush into buying a house where we immediately landed in the UK. We wanted to spend some time looking around, finding a place that really suited us.
Born and bred Brit, Reese, who emigrated in the 1990s, has fond memories of the UK. But for Cathy, who moved to South Africa from Scotland when she was just 2 years old, it's all new. Now they've spent some time getting familiar with life here, they're ready for a more rural setting.
The reason that we want to move away from Reading is because the intention was always to try and find somewhere rurally. I grew up in a town. I really don't want to live in a town. I'm remembering summers when I was younger, and I continue to tell my friends in South Africa that there's nothing nicer than a summer's evening in rural England, especially if there's a pub nearby.
For Cathy, it's about finally finding somewhere the family can settle into British life.
I'm really looking forward to finding a place in the countryside, finding that perfect house and spreading our roots and just settling down. We have two boys. Adam's the eldest, he's 14. Scott's the youngest, at 10. I think they're also looking forward to moving into their own house with their own bedrooms that we can finally get out all their things and just settling into their daily life, making new friends.
When it comes to making their country move, there are two other important members of the family to consider.
In 1995, I bought a Triumph Stag. Always wanted one ever since I was a little boy. And I'm really looking forward to taking it out on the open roads, driving it through the countryside, through those little leafy lanes with the top down, stopping at a pub for a pint.
We have a little Jack Russell, Coco, who's just the best dog in the whole wide world.
It's almost like having another child. Well, for Kathy, it is. She loves to go for a walk, and we like to walk the dog. So, you know, it's nice leafy country lanes, walking through fields, footpaths, all those sorts of things.
I don't quite know how she's going to handle seeing all the squirrels and rabbits.
With two sons, a dog, a classic car, and Reese's job for a technology company in West London to consider, there's only one county they have their eye on.
We're looking to move to the Buckinghamshire area. We think it's going to give us the balance of what we're looking for in terms of location and proximity to where I work.
The lifestyle is quite different moving from South Africa to here. Never mind just moving into the countryside. I think it's just moving to a whole new country. It's a massive move for us, but it's a challenge and it's going to be fun.
Yeah, it is.
Reese and Kathy are open to living anywhere in Bucks, within commuting distance of Reese's work in West London. But before we start looking at houses, we're meeting up in their chosen county to discuss what they want from the move.
Welcome to Buckinghamshire.
Thank you.
When was the last time you actually bought property on the UK market?
It would have been about 1989.
Wow. So yeah. The market has changed a lot since then.
Sure it
has.
And tell me about your wish list, because it's quite extensive.
For me, I'll be working from home some of the time, so it's important to have a nice study. I love fires, so a nice fireplace is important for me too, and a double garage for the car that we've brought with us.
What about you, Kathy? What's on your wish list?
Ideally, four bedrooms. I'd like a nice large kitchen. Probably three reception rooms if possible.
That's quite a wish list in terms of space.
Yes.
Is there any room for compromise?
For the right house, we'd compromise on anything, really, to be honest with you. None of it is really cast in stone.
We've brought a lot of our furniture over with us, so ideally we'd like to keep as much of it as we can.
So how much stuff did you bring from South Africa?
Two container loads.
Two containers?
I probably should have sold a bit more before we moved.
In terms of, choosing a house together, I get the impression that you're not so keen on the kind of little kind of cottagey things, but I got the impression that you might like that.
I don't mind nooks and crannies. Kath prefers more open space.
Yeah.
So that might be a challenge that we'll have to get through.
It's just as long as, like, the windows aren't these pokey little things that you barely get a bead of light coming through.
In terms of your budget, remind us again of how much money we have to spend.
Absolute maximum is £700,000.
A lot of the viewers who watch the show regularly are going, Buckinghamshire?
Yeah. I'm naive when it comes to Buckinghamshire.
We wanted to set you a challenge.
Yeah.
Well, hopefully we have risen to the challenge and that you'll love some of the properties. We've got some lovely properties. And the rain looks like it's easing off a bit, so shall we head out and see them?
Sounds great.
For a maximum budget of £700,000, Reese and Kathy would like a large kitchen, three reception rooms, a home office and four bedrooms. A double garage and dog-friendly garden are desirable, and whilst Reese likes nooks and crannies, Kathy is after clean lines and bright spaces. So quite a demanding wish list, but we found three great properties to tempt them with. At each, I'll be getting them to guess the price before I reveal it. And the final tour is our mystery house, which could just polarise opinion. Our search is starting on the outskirts of Stowe, a civil parish famous for an independent school of the same name, with the hamlet of Chackmore located a couple of miles away. Once lined with timber-framed thatched cottages, just two remain. But there are still plenty of the leafy lanes Reese is looking forward to exploring in his classic car, as well as a traditional country pub. Back on the outskirts of Stowe, the house we've come to see is located down another country lane and holds a rather horsey history.
Here we have it, house number one.
Wow.
Okay.
It's the stables of the much bigger manor house just over there.
Okay.
Brilliant.
What a fantastic area. We're right next to Stowe School. I don't know, it's one of the finest schools in the country. And this, I think, is a charming property. What do you think of the outside?
I like the brickwork.
Yeah.
Plasterwork's really nice. Mm-hmm. Nice colour. Looks very nice on the outside, I can tell you that.
A little bird tells me that you're not so keen on conversions.
Historically, I've not been a fan. You know, maybe there's room for some
we'll
movement.
We'll convert him yet.
Convert him to conversions?
Yes, absolutely.
That'll happen.
Yeah.
Shall we go inside?
Sure.
Let's do that.
The building of this former manorial stable block dates back to the 19th century, but it was converted to a home 20 years ago. It retains some period features, including its clock tower, complete with bells, but it's clear the interior is more about the clean lines Cathy has asked for.
Oh, here we have a nice kitchen.
Big kitchen.
The inside of the property is very beautifully maintained. Yeah. This is a totally bespoke kitchen. There isn't a handle anywhere.
I love the stone tiles.
Yeah, mm-hmm. I like the tiles.
Lovely feature.
Yeah.
It's definitely the sort of effect we're looking for.
And then you've got a nice little utility room there with all your white goods, your washing machine, and also another door so you could bring in with Coco and you clean her paws off.
Yes, she does get muddy.
It's kind of the spec we were looking for, you know, nice older style house with a modernish interior.
Is it bright and big enough for you?
It is a very nice bright kitchen, thank you very much.
Mm. Let's look at some of the other reception rooms.
Back across the hall and past a useful cloakroom, the dining room includes the home's feature staircase.
Come straight through. So you've got the dining area here, and then this big, living space.
Do you like the fireplace, Rhys?
Yeah, I like the fireplace.
You wanted modern interiors? This is actually very sleek and modern.
Yeah.
That's very nice. I like the amount of light coming through the double doors there, leading to the garden.
In terms of size, is this going to be enough?
I'm concerned that the dining room might be a bit small. We've got quite a big square table.
Yeah, we'll have to see whether that'll fit in.
Mm-hmm. So you're going to buy a house around your dining table?
Well, there's certain furniture that we won't compromise on, and that is one of them.
It's a lovely piece, yeah.
So when you said three reception rooms, you meant the kitchen diner as one of them?
No, we had two lounges. so we've got two furniture suites, so...
So you might have to scale that down.
We might have to scale it down, yes.
Rhys and Cathy may need a little readjusting to the typical dimensions of British country living. The central feature staircase splits to give access to two upper wings in the eaves of the house. One side is the family bathroom, which serves a bedroom currently used as a single, but large enough to accommodate a double bed. And a further small bedroom. The third bedroom on this wing is a good size and has ensuite facilities. Then, over on the other wing, we're checking out the largest bedroom.
This is the master suite, with a little shower room here. And then that's actually the little door that goes up into the clock tower, if you're brave enough to take that challenge.
Oh, really?
Oh, OK.
A bit cobwebby.
I like the way it's split. I like the way they've got the divide and the staircase up, and it's
so you can't hear the children.
Nice. That obviously is a benefit. Yeah.
It's got a high, airy feel, you're right. Sometimes
conversion's spacious.
Everything is at a decent level that you're not going to be ducking. You don't feel like you're in the attic.
An upbeat finish to the layout of this converted stable block. And outside, there's the double garage Rhys has asked for, as well as off-street parking for six cars. Leading out from the largest reception room, there's patio dining, plus some mature shrubs and trees surrounding the garden, which is mainly lawn.
It's not a huge garden, but I got the impression that you're not such a mad keen gardener that you want a huge garden.
That's right. I mean, a smaller garden where we could spend the same amount of time in but do more with is probably what we're looking for. So less time mowing the lawn, more time, you know, beautifying the garden, getting some nice flowers in, that sort of thing.
What do you think this one's on the market for?
I think up near the top end of the budget, I think round about 685.
I think Cathy's pretty well on the mark with that, about 685, maybe a touch higher.
He likes to agree with me.
Well, yes, you're right. It is actually up towards the top of your budget, but actually even higher. It's right at the top at 700,000.
Right.
Okay.
Why don't you have another look inside, see whether it kind of enchants you, and then we'll go on and see the next property.
Okay.
Yep, we'll do that. Thanks a lot.
I mean, it is a lovely house, but, you know, maybe a bit squishy for two container loads of South African furniture. But that's the price of property in this very lovely part of the world, so let's see what they think.
This converted stable block combines a period exterior with modern living. there's a bespoke kitchen breakfast room and two further reception rooms, whilst upstairs there are four bedrooms, two with ensuite bathrooms. Outside offers a double garage and gardens in a secluded country location.
What do you think?
That's very nice. I do like the wood. I love exposed wood.
The house is absolutely lovely. It's got a nice, light, airy feel to it.
There are elements that I really like. I think the kitchen's a great kitchen, the sort of thing we're looking for. I love the stonework on the floor. I think the clock tower's a fantastic feature.
The bedrooms, lovely, but the small bedroom's really, really small, and I can see a big argument between my two boys as to who would get the ensuite shower and who wouldn't.
Overall, I think the house is just a little small for what we're trying to get to.
Slightly damp, but beautiful gardens. Maybe not for them. All right, guys.
Yeah.
Are we done? Yes, great, Cathy. You pull the door. We're going to head on to the next house.
Okay, thanks.
Ready?
Let's do that.
As in many parts of the UK, bright yellow fields of oilseed rape flowers are now a familiar part of Buckinghamshire's summer patchwork. It's likely the plant was first brought here by the Romans and used in the Middle Ages as a soil improver. The steam engines of the Industrial Revolution were kept well lubricated with its oil, but for all those centuries, a naturally occurring acid made the plant poisonous and unpalatable for humans. Then, in the 1970s, Canadian scientists developed an edible strain, and canola, standing for Canadian oil, low acid, was born. In the 1980s, subsidies encouraged many European farmers to switch to the crop. And at one such farm, sixth-generation farmer Simon Mead is going to show Rhys and keen cook Cathy the process from soil to oil.
Welcome to our crop of Chilton rapeseed oil. Our family's been here since 1850s. I've been farming since I've left school, but it wasn't until the 80s that we started growing oilseed rape.
What's the growing process? Does it grow all year round?
Well, it starts its life in August. It's been in the ground already 9 months. It's at the pollination stage at the moment, so all the pods are being formed, and we've got another 2 months to go before we harvest it. Some people think it's the flower that we get the oil from, but in fact the flower gets pollinated and produces these pods, and in these pods there's some seeds, and it's the seeds that we get the oil from.
British production of oilseed rape has doubled in the last decade alone, making it such a common sight that during the flowering season, coachloads of tourists regularly stop off to aim their selfie sticks at our canary-coloured fields. If you look at the label of low-cost vegetable oil, chances are you'll see it's rapeseed. It's the artisan, single-estate, cold-pressed varieties that really get those gastronomic tongues wagging. Cold pressing is an extraction process that keeps the heat below 40 degrees Celsius, and it can be done by hand. But here, a machine uses high pressure to literally squeeze the oil from the seed.
There's still lots of sediment in the oil once it comes off the press, but in here it passes through the filter and all the little particulates stay in the filter, and we're left with something like this.
Wow.
The cleaned oil is then bottled at a rate of up to 2,000 bottles a day.
Come on, speed up.
Okay, oh, it's a race. Okay.
These guys are good.
A pourer and threaded cap are added to the top of each.
Marvellous. All done.
And finally, a label is added.
That's the bottle ready to be boxed.
Rapeseed has half the saturated fats of olive oil and 10 times as much omega-3. Plus, the high smoke point makes it suitable for frying and roasting. As well as the plain oil, this farm produces a variety of infusions.
Rhys, Cath, I've got some flavours that I'd like you to try.
This looks good.
I've got some lovely porcini oil. It's good for enhancing a risotto, pastas, and cooking chicken.
Wow. You can really taste the porcini in it.
Straight away. That is delicious.
Next up, it's the basil chili infusion.
Takes a little while to get going.
But I tell you, I can feel it now.
That can be used on any food that you want a little buzz
nice
to.
Little
yeah,
mm.
No, that works nicely.
And lastly, it's the basil flavoured oil.
Good all-rounder.
That'd be good for salad.
That's good.
Very much
nice
so.
Nice rocket mozzarella.
Oh, yeah, that's good.
Salad goes really well.
That would do a good salad.
These are really nice.
I think the flavours are awesome.
I'll tell you what, if they all taste like this, I'm converted.
Good.
Reese and Kathy may be converts to English rapeseed oil, but let's see if we can find the missing ingredient in their move, their dream home, here in the Buckinghamshire countryside. We're taking our search to the village of Granborough. In 1833, this largely agricultural settlement was considered such a tough place to live that the vicar of St John the Baptist's appealed to the local squire to create alternatives for the poor to spending their winter evenings in the pub. Despite his protestations, the crown is still going strong. But other activities do regularly take place in the attractive half-timbered hall built in 1910. The nearest shop is a community-run affair about a mile away in neighbouring North Marston. And the house we've come to see is back in Granborough, located in a close at the heart of the village.
A very different offering in a great village.
Yeah.
Again, it was stables, seems to be a real theme. These were the stables to this house, one of the bigger houses in the village.
Okay.
Now, I'll tell you one thing that is different is how quiet it is here.
Will it tick all the boxes? That's the question.
Will it?
Fingers crossed.
Will there be space for the dining room table?
Will there be space? We all have to see.
Nail-biting stuff. Let's have a look inside.
Converted from Victorian stables in 1992, the front door leads to an L-shaped corridor, to the left of which is something that should please Kathy, the first of three reception rooms.
I'm just going to stop off in the dining room. Is this big enough for the table?
Do you know, I think it might be.
Oh, I think this is good, yeah.
It's a nice big square room.
It is.
Nice
it is quiet.
Big windows yeah. From floor to ceiling, practically.
It's a nice natural light coming through there.
A great start, and the dining room leads straight into a large kitchen breakfast room.
What about the proportions?
It's a very nice size kitchen.
Through there you've got a utility room with a tumble dryer and washer and a downstairs loo.
Okay.
The layout's good, the finishings are really nice.
I wouldn't walk in here thinking I needed to do a huge amount of work straight away. No. You've got the nook over here, so it's still a fully functional area for breakfast and things like that.
Yeah. Good.
It's looking good.
Smiling.
We're smiling, yeah. We're smiling.
Well, still more good stuff to come. Let's look and look at this room, which is the lovely double doors out into the garden and this
with
huge space.
The view.
Yeah. This
and
is nice.
An instant fire.
Oh, right, okay.
Fires are always good. Yeah. Obviously, first prize would be wood or anthracite. But a fire's a fire. It looks the part. It's a nice sized room, this, isn't it? It's a nice sized reception room.
In terms of bedrooms, there are four bedrooms.
Okay.
One of them, the main ones, is downstairs. I'd probably keep that as a guest wing because it's got its own little bathroom.
Okay.
But I'm going to show you one of the ones upstairs.
Upstairs, yeah.
Heading back to the stairs in the corridor, we also find the third reception room, which completes this floor. Then upstairs, there is a family bathroom serving three further double bedrooms. The first is located above the ground floor master, next to which is another with an inset window. And then the largest of the upper floor bedrooms makes bedroom number four.
This is a nice, bright room. They're all sort of the same size upstairs.
In fact, they're quite a nice size, all the bedrooms.
So the boys won't have to arm wrestle to get
them. They won't have to arm wrestle for the biggest one.
They'll find a reason
to arm
wrestle.
They'll find something else to arm wrestle over. I like the fact that there's the one ensuite bedroom downstairs. I would have preferred that upstairs, but you can't have...
Everything
that you wish for.
I like the space, I like the layout. It's got lots of potential.
The nice thing about this property is the scope for expansion, because we don't have, as yet, a suitable office for you.
Right.
Maybe we do.
Lead on.
Kathy and Reese are both seeing plenty of potential in this generously laid-out home. Outside, there's a third of an acre of garden, as well as patio seating to enjoy the extensive countryside views. Plus, a large double garage with power that could just offer them another option.
Now, my thought about your study, since it's nice to have a workspace that's outside of the house, the present owner was suggesting going up into the roof of this big double garage. It's a huge space.
Yeah, it is big.
And the roof space could quite easily be converted.
That could potentially be an idea.
There is absolutely enough space.
This one is starting to look more like what we're after.
What do you think of the outside space?
The garden's lovely, great size. The entertaining space is just right. I mean, we've got some patio things we're bringing with us. I think this garden's really, really lovely.
What do you think this one's on the market for?
Right, so, well, it's pretty tough considering the previous house. We pitched lower on that, and I was quite surprised at the price tag.
I would say 665.
No, I would go 685.
It is under budget, but you're a little optimistic. It's actually on at £695,000.
Okay.
This one seems like it's got longer legs.
Yeah.
So why don't you go inside and I'll see you later.
This converted semi-detached stable block offers a generous amount of accommodation with a large kitchen breakfast room, three reception rooms and four double bedrooms, including that ground floor ensuite. There's also a detached double garage and it's all in a central village location.
Yes, what I like about this is there's plenty of space up here to put an office. I think it's nice and high. From the car's perspective, you've got enough space for two big cars here and some extra.
And some workspace, yeah.
I think this house is really, really nice. The rooms are lovely and spacious, like the size of the bedrooms. I like the three reception rooms. The size of them is really good.
The location's pretty good here. The garden's just absolutely gorgeous and everything we want from a garden in a house we're looking for.
Nice space for the kids to run around in, the dog to enjoy. Like the fact that it looks over onto farmland, which has given us the real sense of being in the country, which is what we wanted.
It's a contender, I think. The price was a bit of a surprise. We are beginning to realise we are going to have to seriously think about making some compromises to find the house that we need to.
Come on out of the garden. I'm going to have to drag you away from this one, I'm afraid.
You will have to drag us away.
So that's it for today. So you can have some time to sleep on these.
Ponder over it.
And then we've got the mystery house tomorrow.
Excellent.
We're in the Buckinghamshire countryside helping Reese and Kathy, who have recently moved from South Africa, to find their dream family home. We've already shown them two takes on converted stables for their £700,000 budget, but we've got something completely different lined up for the mystery house, which could prove the adage, opposites attract.
It's a very low ceiling. I feel quite claustrophobic in here, yeah.
I'm feeling completely the opposite.
I know, I knew you would, yeah.
Absolutely lovely.
Plus, I'm taking things at a snail's pace at one very unusual Buckinghamshire farm.
So snails shoot love arrows at each other?
Yeah.
They're like Cupid. This is a fascinating house hunt, because it's really interesting to see Reese and Kathy's sort of bamboozlement at what's happened in the housing market in the UK in the 20 years they've been away in South Africa, particularly since they calculated that their £700,000 budget is 14 million rand. The mystery house, however, is, well, it's a bit of an offering for Reese, sort of playing to his desire for an old-fashioned English sort of fantasy country house. But in the garden, there's a slice of South Africa that's going to appeal to the two boys.
Our mystery offering is located in the village of Nash. 5 miles away, the small market town of Stony Stratford includes a high street with a range of traditional shops, but it's also the source of a few tall tales.
But this is historically a very important town in the coaching routes up and down the country. So it's interestingly the beginning of the cock and bull story. Are you familiar with that?
Yes.
Like the nonsense story?
Yeah, the nonsense story.
Because
yeah.
You have two hotels, the bull and down there's the cock. And so when the coaches used to go through, they used to compete about who had the most outrageous stories from London.
OK.
Fascinating.
That's not a little bit of cock and bull you've just told
no,
us, then.
No, that's true.
Well, between you and I, many believe the phrase really originates from old fairy tales around cocks and bulls. And back in Nash, the mystery house is something you might also find in a fairy tale.
Here we have it. It's the mystery house.
It's a...
It's thatch, it's old, it's all the things you don't like. But it is kind of what you were asking for.
It is. I think it's very pretty. I mean, it really is old English history here. You can see that. Unlike my wife, I don't mind the thatch roof.
Yeah, I'm not fond of thatch.
It's essence of countryside, yeah.
Actually, thatch is an incredibly green, ecologically friendly and very effective insulator.
Okie dokes.
And there are no more spiders than in your normal roof.
Ah, OK.
Shall we look in?
Yeah, let's have a look.
Tight-lipped.
I'll smile soon.
Dating back at least 5 centuries, this Grade II listed cottage has a recent addition on the near end. whilst a Victorian addition at the far end was once home to the village shop. But it's now a classic country kitchen, which I'm hoping will sell itself to Cathy.
Oh dear, I've already got a rolling eye.
Oh dear, it's a very low ceiling.
Right.
I feel quite claustrophobic in here, yeah.
I'm feeling completely the opposite.
I know, I knew you would, yeah.
Absolutely lovely.
The kitchen itself is lovely. I can appreciate that there's lots of things in here that I do like. You've got me the gas cooker, which was on my list. I love cooking with gas. We have got lovely granite tops, which was something that we both love, yeah.
On, yeah. Well, it gets more historic as we go around.
Okay. Lead
<That's>
on.
Excellent.
From the kitchen, we enter the oldest part of the house and pass through a dining room with fully beamed ceiling and inglenook fireplace.
So through the dining room into the main sitting room.
Look at the character. Look at the stone that's open. Look at the wooden lintel. I mean, this is just perfect country cottage stuff.
Keep going, Reese. Keep going. This is going to break soon. This is going to break.
This is what we're looking
for. He's got his rosy tinted glasses on. I can see that there.
I think this is a fantastic find, guys. Well done.
I think I could be sold, but I need to think about it.
It's not vast, though.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Doesn't have a third reception room as it stands.
Okay.
I think this is a lovely little house.
So, obviously, Africa has the oldest history of all humanity, but they didn't build houses that lasted as long as this.
No, we certainly don't have anything as old as this that I know of.
Let's have a look upstairs.
Let's have a look upstairs.
You can explore later all the nooks and crannies.
This period cottage might not have that third reception room, but the newer extension does offer a ground floor utility, as well as the first of four bedrooms, which is served by a ground floor bathroom. Stairs at this end of the house lead up to a rather intriguing trapdoor double bedroom, meaning Reese and Kathy's two boys might enjoy having the run of this wing of the house. We're taking the stairs from the dining room to the rest of the accommodation in the other wing, where we find the part-tiled family bathroom, a guest bedroom with feature timbers, and then in the centre of the home is the largest bedroom, number four.
This is what they're using as the master bedroom. Another little slice of history up in the beams.
Higher ceiling. I was expecting to see thatch on the inside.
No.
They do that in South Africa, and that's why you have your eight-legged friends inside the house.
No arachnids in this thatch.
I like the configuration. Kids at one end of the house, us at the other end of the house. That makes a lot of sense. Nice and airy as well. I think you get a lot of light in here. But yeah, I think this fits the bill quite nicely for me.
I know. You're loving this.
This characterful cottage has clearly captured Reese, but perhaps the outside space will help to win Cathy over too. Set in 3/4 of an acre of grounds, there's lots of space for a kickabout, as well as plenty of parking. A garden room offers versatility, plus an outdoor pool with pool house is a real bonus.
We couldn't bring you here without giving a little bit of South African luxury. Swimming pool.
A swimming pool. For that one day in summer when the sun shines.
Oh, it's actually a really nice touch because we had a pool back in Johannesburg.
Yeah.
And we enjoyed it a lot.
Yeah.
And the kids are still young enough to enjoy it.
So what do you think of the garden? Is this sort of a good size?
Yeah, I think it's the right size. It looks like relatively low maintenance. So I'll take the lawn because I like the house.
Well, what do you think the price tag on this one is?
I think that we're looking at about 675, 685 on this. I'll give it a 10,000 leeway.
I would say 680.
680. Okay, in this instance, interestingly, you're both a bit pessimistic because this is on the market for £650,000.
Okay,
that sounds like a good number for a house with so much history.
Why don't you guys go have a look inside? There's lots of nooks and crannies. Don't get stuck. And I'll see you outside in a few minutes.
We'll do that.
Thanks. We'll shout for help if we get stuck in a tiny hidey hole.
I'll rescue you. Well, that went better than I expected because I thought Cathy would hate this house, and she kind of did at the beginning, but Reese is quite persuasive, the history's quite persuasive, and hopefully she might be persuaded.
Coming in £50,000 below budget, this Grade 2 listed thatched cottage has a large country kitchen, 2 reception rooms, 4 bedrooms and 2 bathrooms. It also comes with 3/4 of an acre garden, the pool and outbuildings.
Oh, Reese, a nice little sewing room.
Yeah, for when you finished in the kitchen. Oh, this is very good. I think we could definitely do something with this. This last house really does tick the major box that I'm looking for, and that is a historic old house. You know, grade two listing, 500 years old, when there are lots of features inside the house that really appeal to me. I think I've got a bit of work to do convincing Kathy that this is the sort of thing that would suit her as well as me.
I think Rhys is loving this house. I think it's exactly what he imagined he was going to find. The kitchen's quite unusual, but I do love the granite tops. I love the cooker. It's a nice square kitchen. It's got lovely lights. I must admit, it's quite a quirky house, so it could grow on me.
If we compare and contrast a little bit with where we've come from, you know, we're looking at a budget of £700,000. That would buy us a house probably twice the size on two, three times the size of land. Yeah, that's what we've given up, but it's something that we're really happy we've done. And if we can end up with a house like this, it'll be totally worthwhile.
There you go. Oh, there you are. Great. Tear you away from your newfound love.
Yeah.
Still not quite convinced.
Not convinced.
You've got some work there.
Yeah, I know.
Let's go and find a spot where we can kind of gather our thoughts about all the houses.
Okay,
excellent.
Thanks.
Buckinghamshire's desirable location close to the capital means that over the years, many former farmsteads have become spacious homes for city commuters with little agricultural activity. As traditional crops and cattle farming have taken a back seat, the most common farm type in the county is the specialist category. And I've come to meet Sophie Wharton, who for the last 7 years has been producing a decidedly unusual harvest from what is now the biggest commercial outdoor snail farm in the UK.
I want to know how on earth you got into snails.
It was an accident. I wanted to grow microherbs, got distracted, brought a few snails. We had them in the front room in a big plastic box, trying to feed them all kinds of things. It was just amusing us. They'd been mating, and before we knew it, the snails had started us a business rather than us starting a business. So it was a massive learning curve.
So how many snails are you producing on this little plot?
This park will produce 3 ton. It's about 340,000 snails.
Oh my goodness. What kind of snails are we talking about? They're not garden snails.
To you, they would look very similar to the garden snail. However, ours are quite a lot bigger. Ours are faster growing.
Okay.
Because a typical garden snail in UK would take 2 years to come up to being an adult size, whereas our snails will come up to size by September.
To help her snails grow as quickly as possible, Sophie feeds them a diet of rapeseed plants supplemented with snail flour, a special mix of grains enriched with calcium and vitamins. This batch is just 9 days old, but come the autumn, they'll be fully grown and ready to be harvested.
Obviously, you breed some snails to eat?
Yes, some of these snails will go as chef snails for the table, and some of the snails we hold back, then go on to produce for our caviar.
Yes, you heard it right, snail caviar. And those selected to make this diner's delicacy are destined for a polytunnel nicknamed the Tunnel of Love by Sophie, and she's offered to show me the action.
Aha!
Come in.
The Tunnel of Snail Love.
Snails are hermaphrodites, and when these are ready to reproduce, they develop a hard calcium shard, known as a love dart, which they fire into a fellow snail. This causes hormonal changes, making pairing more likely to succeed.
So snails shoot love arrows at each other?
Yeah.
They're like Cupid.
Yeah. If you look on the back of here, you can see a couple of arrows there.
Oh, yeah,
so someone must have been stood on the edge and missed.
Once mating starts, it can last from 4 hours to 2 days.
They decide how long, and it's usually dependent on the weather conditions. So if it's going to bucket it down of rain, they'll actually speed it up. And then, again, when they produce their eggs, it will take them up to 2 days to lay their eggs. So these snails are already mid-flow of laying.
Let's see what this one's doing.
There's one just coming out now, look. Look at him squeezing it out.
They're like little pearls.
Each clutch contains anything from 60 to 120 eggs, which are then collected to be cleaned and cured. At £40 for 30 grams, this snail caviar is definitely a luxury item, and I'm about to have my very first mouthful.
Snail caviar.
It's nothing like what you're going to expect it to be like.
It's a light caviar, but not quite as fishy.
Yeah.
Who knew? And so then you can serve it in these fancy little...
Yeah,
Yeah, some canapes that we've made up. It's black pudding, monkfish, creme fraiche, and poppy seed breadcrumbs.
So this is how they serve it in the posh restaurants?
Yeah, enjoy.
That's very good. So what's really lovely about this, because this is so high-end, but see the way that you're so delighted by the snails still.
I mean, they do their job for me and I have to do a good job to look after them.
Thank you, Sophie, it's so wonderful.
Good. Glad you enjoyed it.
Reese will have to have pulled out all the stops to persuade Cathy that that period thatched very higgledy-piggledy property is her dream home. But stranger things have happened, so let's find out what this couple think about their week in Buckinghamshire. Here we are. It's a typical little corner of Buckinghamshire, the Claydon Estate. So what are your thoughts about Buckinghamshire, about this move after our week of house hunting?
We've seen three lovely houses. Really nice. Perhaps not quite fitting what we're looking for.
Oh, it's like a knife through my heart to hear that.
The mystery house clearly struck a chord with me. I think we had a view that we would be able to easily get everything we were looking for, and that's probably a bit naive. And the question is, what are we going to compromise on?
I think I'd possibly give thatch more of a chance now than I would have done before, mostly because it's not thatch on the inside as well. Having the ceiling boards does stop Mr. Eight Legs coming down at night. But I still think that these period houses might just still be a little bit too quirky for me.
So I've still got some work to do to convince Cathy that that's exactly what we're going to end up with.
What happens next? What is the next step?
I think it's now a lot of weekend work to go out there and see what's there, what else is there.
Well, it's a bitter disappointment that we haven't managed to get you the house of your dreams on the show, but it's been really lovely showing, and very fascinating, actually, to see your sort of South African eyes on our housing market. So I wish you all the best, and I'm sure you will find the perfect house if you keep on looking.
Thank you. Very much. Thanks for your time this week. It's been great, yeah.
It's really fascinating seeing the UK property market through the eyes of a homecomer, particularly someone who's been away for 20 or more years. And I guess property prices in Buckinghamshire do look pretty shocking when you fear that you've got 14 million rand in your pocket. Nonetheless, I think also that this week has focused Cathy and Reese's eyes on the prize, and they'll find that house with a little more searching. And I hope that you join us next time for more Escape to the Country.
Reese and Cathy continued their search and eventually found a property in the village of Nash, the location of our mystery house. They put in an offer and it was accepted. We wish them all the very best for the future. And if you would like to escape to the country in Northern Ireland, Scotland, Wales or England and need our help, you can apply online at bbc.co.uk/beonashow.